Egg.
Hello.
Hello.
Well, how do plants manage to grow so big? To get from something this size to the size of a tree. Let's see how far we took the story last week.
Remember, the seed swells, starts to grow, and the roots go down, and the shoot goes up.
But have you ever asked yourself, why do roots go down, and why do shoots go up? There must be some reason.
Well, remember that to grow, you need energy. You need food. A bean seed starts off with its own emergency rations. If we just break this into two, there they are. It's these food stores here, just like our peanut last week. And they do pretty well. Just these and water give enough energy to get the plant growing to about this size. Pretty impressive, but they won't last forever. If the plant is going to survive, it needs more food.
So the roots are going down into the soil for food and drink, of course. One of the main jobs of the roots is taking up water from the soil, because if you pour water on the soil, it doesn't stay on top, but sinks down. So the roots have to go down too.
This speeded up film shows roots growing, searching out water in the soil. If there are rocks in the way, they grow around them.
If you look carefully at a plant like this, you can see the roots, and it's these roots that take up the water from the soil.
But of course it's not pure water that the roots take in. Let's just mix together some water and soil. And once the water is in the soil, as you can see, it starts to get very cloudy, doesn't it? It's not very nice for us to drink, but to the plants it's terrific. It's full of goodness. Minerals from the soil. Dissolved in the water are the vital minerals the plant needs to grow.
And the other main job for the roots is to hold the plant steady in the soil so that the stem, this part, can grow up into the air. Different plants have different ways of growing upwards. Some plants have strong stems, some are much weaker. Trees have very strong stems, trunks, so they can grow very tall. Some plants have such weak stems, they need to hang on to something else for support. Bean plants have very thin stems, so they need to twist round a support. Speed it up, it looks like a strange dance. Peas are even stranger. They send out tendrils, grab hold of a support, and sort of wind themselves up. Sweet peas do the same.
But why are all these plants so busy reaching for the sky? What's up there that's going to help them survive? The sun. Plants reach up to get their energy from sunlight.
Energy from light is a bit hard to believe. But look at this. Most calculators need batteries to work. But this one gets its energy from light, picked up on this light panel here.
And look at this car. It's getting its energy from the studio lights. If I block off the panel on top, it stops. If I give it light again, It's got the energy to move.
Of course, plants don't need energy to move, but they need it to grow. And this plant, like most plants, has lots of light panels to take in energy from the sun. Leaves. Have you ever noticed the way that leaves are arranged in patterns? It's not for decoration. In various different ways, the leaves are arranged so that as much light as possible falls on them, because light gives plants the vital energy they need to grow. So the story of our bean plant continues. The roots go down, picking up water and minerals from the soil, and the stem climbs up, twisting itself round the nearest support and lifting the leaves up into the air to catch the sunlight. Everything the plant needs to grow is there. If you go out into a garden, you can see for yourself the different ways plants struggle to grow and survive. I went to Norwood Hall to look at the garden there. If you stop looking after a garden, it will end up looking something like this. A bit of a jungle, with all the plants competing for the light and moisture they need to survive. Even here on this old wall, there are plants trying to grow, and some of them are doing very well. They're high up, so they catch the light. Their roots can find enough soil in the cracks in the wall, and they get water when it rains. And why do you think they're doing so well just here? Well, this broken pipe should give you the clue. When it rains, all the water that should go down the drain pipe goes down the wall instead, making it a better place for the plants to survive. Plants in a beautiful garden like this have life pretty easy. We give them plenty of water and pull out any weeds to stop them taking over. But even here, some of the plants are having to compete for the things they need to stay alive. Look at these flowers. See the way they're leaning over? They're having to struggle to find the light because this tree is in the way. Trees are kings of the plant world. They grow so big and tall that very often they cut out the light from other plants. Looking up, I can see why. There's so many leaves so close together that very little light can get through. And there's not much light left for other plants to grow underneath the tree. There are hundreds of different types of trees, and some let more light through than others. They all have good strong roots to supply water and minerals from the soil, and to stop them toppling over as they grow taller and taller. So, can you guess why this tree is so small? It looks like a normal tree, and it was grown from a normal seed. But its roots have been carefully cut, so they don't grow too big. And look how shallow this dish is. And if the roots don't grow normally, then the rest of the tree doesn't grow normally either. Start investigating the world of plants, you keep coming across surprises. This greenhouse is like the jungle, very warm and damp, a bit like the swimming baths on a hot day. In fact, the air is so damp that this plant doesn't get water from the soil. Its roots hang in the air, which is damp enough to give the plant all the moisture it needs. Some plants live in the water. No problem for them finding moisture. But why don't they sink? If you go swimming, have you ever worn water wings? They're full of air to help you to float. Well, take a look at this plant. I'll break off a bit, carefully. And this part of the plant is full of air. If I push it under the water and squeeze, you can see the air bubbling out. These plants float because they've got their own built-in water wings. Plants lose water through their leaves. If it gets too hot and they lose too much water, they die. Look at this plant with its leaves spread out. Suppose the sun got too hot. How can the plant hide its leaves from the heat? Let's add some extra heat and see what happens. See how the leaves fold up, so they aren't in the direct heat of the sun anymore. The message goes round the whole plant. It's not dead. It will go back to normal again in a few minutes. Plants need minerals to help them grow properly. Suppose a plant can't get enough minerals from the soil. Can it get them from anything else? Some plants can. There are minerals in insects' bodies. And this plant, the sundew, has sticky hairs that trap them. The insects die, and the plant can get the minerals it needs from the dead bodies. When an insect goes down inside a pitcher plant, it slips down inside, and there are little hairs that stop it climbing out again. Another meal for a plant. The Venus flytrap captures quite big insects. If an insect touches the hairs inside, the trap springs shut. And when it opens again, days later, the insect will have been swallowed up by the plant.
But usually it's the plant that gets eaten, often by people.
There's plenty to eat in the picnic this week. These are all foods that come from the roots, the stem, or the leaves of plants. Carrots, rhubarb,
lettuce, and yams. And one of our most important drinks comes from the leaves of a plant.
A tea plant. This is what a tea leaf really looks like. Insects like to eat plants too.
And sometimes you can find a lot of different insects on the same plant. These creatures are called aphids. They are drinking the juice of the plant as it rises up the stem.
The ants look after the aphids rather like farmers and their cows. They milk the aphids by rubbing them in a special way and drink the juice themselves.
But there's another insect interested in the aphids. The ladybird likes eating them. So the ants try to fight the ladybirds off to protect their aphids.
The aphids were drinking the sap, the juice rising up the stem of the plant. How could you show that sap rises? Well, here's one way. Colour some water with some food dye and stick a white flower in. The red coloured water will be drawn up through the stem and you'll see it in the flowers. Now, this one's been in the coloured water for a couple of hours and you can see the flecks of colour in the petals.
The sap inside a plant is vital to keep it alive. If it dried out, it would die. And one of the problems with leaves is that they do dry out easily. It's like hanging your washing out, isn't it? So desert plants, like cacti, don't have leaves. These may look like leaves, but they're really parts of the plant's stem. They're specially shaped to get as much sunlight as possible, like leaves do, but they're thick and tough, so they don't lose much water and the plant doesn't dry out. Deserts are tough places to survive in, unless you can find an oasis.
An oasis is like an island of green. And ever since time began, desert travellers have been drawn to them, attracted by the thought of cool shade and a drink to quench their thirst. And sure enough, when you get inside the oasis, you find water. But where does it come from? It's a bit of a mystery, isn't it? You can't see any rivers flowing into the oasis. It's surrounded by dry sand. Well, the answer is, the water comes from under the ground.
If you remember, the earth is made up of layers, and some of these layers contain water. If the water stays far underground, it's not much use. But sometimes it comes close to the surface, and when that happens, the gardeners are in business.
Yes, I did say gardeners. If you thought an oasis was natural, you'd be wrong. It's man-made like any other garden. They start by planting the palm trees. And when these have grown, they dig the irrigation channels. The shade of the trees stops the water in the irrigation channels from drying up. And that allows them to grow crops in the ground under the trees.
Water supplies in the oasis are carefully rationed, and each section takes it in turn to have its channels filled. A quarter of an hour's water each week, that's all it gets. And here it comes.
Water is the precious fluid that makes it all possible. And in this particular oasis, almost anything seems possible.
Call this place Paradise Garden, and that's a very good name because the original word for paradise meant garden in a desert.
Very nice. But you don't have to go to a desert to appreciate a cool, refreshing garden. If you live in a noisy city, a garden can be a very pleasant oasis. In the middle of London, the children of Argyle School can enjoy all the pleasures of gardening. Mowing the lawn, for example. The grass will come in handy for feeding the hamster. Clipping the trees. Watering the plants. Putting in stakes to support them. And even growing their own tomatoes. They can see for themselves how things grow, like this sweet pea climbing up the fence, or the bramble bush on the wall, and how much nicer than a stuffy classroom to be out enjoying the flowers. All very pleasant, just like our flowers here, in fact. But have you ever wondered what on earth is the point of plants having flowers?
They're nice for us to look at, but there were flowers around millions of years before there were people to enjoy them.
Well, there must be a reason, and the vital job that flowers do is what we'll be looking at next week. Goodbye.
Goodbye.